Time now to go across the dictionary corner. Adam, what have you got for us?
Hey, Jimmy, I'm going to take a trip to commentary corner, in which I read out a few genuine internet comments that I've come across on my travels. Got that stray Y there, which is a shame. Or you could think about it as like a Spanish section, though. Comentar y corner. Today, I'm going to relate to you some comments that I've come across about printing. Now, I think that we can all agree that the invention of the printing press in the mid-1400s by Johann Gutenberg was probably one of the second millennium's biggest disappointments on account of, like, all it could print was, like, words and pictures and shit. But now, luckily, we've got 3D printing, and that's changed the whole ball game radically. And minds across the world are boggling with the implications of a technology which potentially enables you to create any actual three-dimensional object. As you will see when I read out some of these genuine comments, which I found beneath some YouTube videos. So let's begin with a thought-provoking one from Joel Tanko, who says, the 3D printer has changed the world. Mm. And the world would be better than worst in the world. Just take some time to think about that. That's enough time. Let's move on to a comment now from Chewbacca Wacka. He is your go-to guy if you need your Wookiee assassinated. And he has this to say. He's one of a number of people that thinks that this would be a great application for the 3D printer. I'm gonna print a printer and then return that printer and get my money. In your face, 3D printing manufacturers, you bunch of dicks. You didn't see that coming, did you? Kevin Kukar, I'm not sure if that's a gas or an electric Kukar. He asks this very important question, which a lot of people are asking online when it comes to 3D printing. Can this print out Hammonds? That's the big question, isn't it? Can this 3D printing technology enable you to actually print out a Hammond Benning? And if so, what kind of Hammond would you print? Well, Razoog the 94th of the noble Razoog clan, has this suggestion. Can I print a whore?
That's exactly the right voice.
I mean, I suppose the answer, though, is yes, you could, but what would be the point? You'd still have to pay them. Why not just visit an actual Hammond whore? Massif Oswald thinks even that would be a waste of money because he has this very specific idea. Print my cock!
Do you think he's using his cock to type? Because so the font is going to... Then
he's alternating.
Uppercase.
He's alternating between his hand and his cock to actually do it.
Ladies and gentlemen, Adam Buxton. Okay, time to go across once more to Dictionary Corner. Adam, what have you got for us this time?
Hello, Jimmy. Now, I love words. And one of the things I love words is that you can use them to make amusing signs. I love amusing signs. And I wanted to share with you one that I saw when I went on a caravanning holiday with my family recently. We spent a couple of weeks in a lovely photographic studio. I saw this sign which tickled me, which said, don't come a-knockin' if the caravan's rockin'. Well, we all know what that means. That's pretty amusing stuff, and I thought that would be good. We should get a sign like that. But we have children, so if we were ever to get to that stage, then most likely the caravan wouldn't actually be rocking. So I thought I should customize the sign a little bit, come up with something slightly different. And these are a few ideas that I had for the sign. First of all, I went with, don't start banging if you can hear banging. And I thought that was a little bit coarse, and maybe overstating things a little bit. So my next attempt was, don't attempt to negotiate access while I am. But then I thought, nah, you're losing something of the poetry of the original, don't come a-knocking if the caravan's rocking. So I went for another rhyming option and had, if you can detect vibrations, we may be having relations. In the end, I thought I'd go for something a little more straightforward. If you knock and no one answers, we're having sexual intercourse.
Adam Buxton, everyone. Adam, what have you got for us?
Well, Jimmy, I'm always impressed when I do watch Countdown with the focus of the people playing these games, how they manage to concentrate and come up with amazing answers. I always think if I was in that position as a contestant, I would find it very difficult, mainly because, like, the inside of my head is like a kind of South London pirate radio station. I'll give you an example of what I mean.
Some letter, no, not that one. Give me one better. X and Q, them so foul. Stop with the consonant, give me some vowel. Come on, brain, do a nice word. Don't make me look like a big, thick turd. Something long, false disgrace. If they get nine, it's in my face. Numbers round, nasty shock. I can't do the math with a musical clock. Time's running out, I'm looking like a clown. I'm on a countdown, break down. Numbers! Letters!
Adam, what have you got for us?
Thanks, Jimmy. I was on the internet the other day. I don't know if you've been there. It's a game changer. And I came across some old clips of Countdown. It was embarrassing, but I lost control. I was enjoying particularly the ones of the numbers rounds, and I enjoy reading some of the comments, the reactions of the YouTubers underneath those clips. I thought I would share some of those with
Terrific.
You. In what I like to call Commentary Corner. I did a logo there. I was a bit upset about the Y. Fitting properly, but there it is. And so this is a cross-section of genuine comments from the internet users, beginning with one from RetroLenzel64, the 64th of the very noble RetroLenzel family. he says he's absolutely amazed at the skills of one of the contestants, the mathematical skills, and he says, I just went through how he managed to calculate it, and I'm stunned at how he managed to calculate it. Beggar's belief. his level of amazement is as large as the belief of a beggar. That's an incredibly strong belief that beggars have because of the special brew which increases credulity. Well, here is a comment from Vicmel30. He's been watching a Countdown numbers clip wherein the contestant chooses four big numbers, right?
Ooh.
Vic Mel is not impressed and says, only wankers do four big numbers. Poor ball bag has a comment. That's a fun name. He is one of many people who I was surprised to find that people leave comments not just about the gameplay, but sometimes about the beautiful Countdown letter ladies, the statisticians, about Rachel and Carol Vorderman as well. Paul Ballbag has a comment directed at Carol Vorderman, and this is a clip that he was watching where Carol is chuckling with amazement at the skills of one of the contestants, chuckling away there. Paul, it's too much for Paul Ballbag. He says to Carol, do your job and stop laughing at Till. And here is one of the many, many comments directed at you, Rachel. This is a nice comment from Turtle Jesus. I mean, I'm assuming that is the answer to the question, what is the slowest kind of jizz? says about you, Rachel, I would drag my balls through 10 miles of broken glass just to hear her fart through a walkie-talkie.
Ladies and gentlemen, Adam Buxton. It's time to go across the Dictionary Corner. Adam, what have you got for us?
Well, Jimmy, we're going to take a little trip to Commentary Corner right now. I misspelt commentary there to make it fit. it makes it look more symmetrical. I hope that's not going to cause any fights. And today we are looking at some genuine YouTube comments for a bit of music that's been uploaded to YouTube. The music is by Brian Eno. It's called An Ending, Ascent. And this is the kind of music that really makes people think deep spiritual thoughts, think about important times in their lives. And where's the best place to share those kinds of thoughts? It's in the YouTube comment section, isn't it? So here is a selection of genuine comments from YouTubers that I found beneath that video, beginning with one from, I think you pronounce that, Nuikjit. And Nuikjit says of that piece of music, oh, my God. I can't comprehend a masterpiece on this scale. Here's a comment from Andrew Purdy, which you're going to need to open your mind as wide as it'll go. Just look at the way he's spelling Andrew there for a start. Andrew says this, reminds me of a feeling I'll never remember. One I've had, but will never have. It evokes in me the unknown sensation of eternity, the sadness and beauty of my existence here on Earth coming to a close as the soil reclaims me and I become one with the universe again. That's the level of YouTube commentary that you need to aspire to. Ray Ray, 66th of the proud Ray Ray clan, responds thusly to Andrew Purdy, I have a similar feeling. It's like trying to ejaculate with a cat's paw plugging your urethra. We've all been there. Here's a comment from Graham the Puna. And he has a moving anecdote that this music reminds him of. When I got my girlfriend pregnant and gave her herpes, she used to listen to this song to stay strong. It was a difficult time for both of us. This song is great! That's a fun anecdote there. From Glenn. And there's a lot of people sharing... A lot of people sharing emotional stories about their lives and what this music reminds me of. And Liam's Cool Channel has a nice message, and he says, this song has also helped me get through all the bad things that has happened to me in my life. And I just want to say thank you for being there. Stay strong, everyone. Hey, hey! That's a nice, nice little cheery message of support there from Liam and his Cool Channel, to which Craig Jones replies, Liam, man, I totally feel you. I've been there. Stay strong, man. Oh, and this song kind of reminds me of my first blowjob. To which Liam replies, giving or receiving, bro. Craig replies, giving it like a trooper, I'm afraid. And finally, Liam responds, disgusting. And signs off with a nice, what's your number?
Adam Buxton, everyone. OK, the scores at the moment, Sean and Mel are on 5. Time to go across to Dictionary Corner. Again, Adam, what have you got for us?
Well, Jimmy, I work from home, and in practical terms, what that means is long bouts of onanism, interrupted by occasional trips to the kitchen. And when I'm in the kitchen, I'm aware of a number of recurring phenomena that I have started to compile in Dr. Buckle's kitchen dictionary. So the first word in Dr. Buckle's kitchen dictionary today is black snacks. This is when, of an afternoon, you fancy a yummy, warm baguette snack and pop it in the oven there, yum, and then you forget. You walk around the house, maybe take a phone call, and then a little while later, bongo, your black snack is ready. Next word in the kitchen dictionary is foil's drift. Now, these are the long rips and tributaries that form on a roll of tin foil.
Oh, yeah.
That has been removed from the cardboard housing and unspooled without sufficient care by my housemates. I say housemates, technically they're my children. And you end up with that that kind of situation, which of course leads to foil's war. And finally, for the kitchen dictionary today, let's take a look at four cunts. Sorry.
Sorry, was I next to Noel Edmonds?
Sorry, that was a mistake. The phrase, of course, is fork hunts. I'm talking about the times when you are scraping food remains into a bin and one of the utensils becomes unbalanced and slips down the side of the bin. And then you have to go on a fork hunt and you're reaching in there and reaching past all the food remains and the pregnant nappies still warm. And it's around about that point that you think, we have other forks. And that is that's it for the kitchen dictionary today, Jimmy.
Adam Buxton. We go across once more to Dictionary Corner. What have you got for us, Adam?
You may or may not know that I am a father, Jimmy. I have three children, all legally mine, and I like them all very much. And I think the feeling's mutual because I'm a fun dad. I'm always thinking of fun things and fun activities for them to do. For example, my son, Nat, he was asking me how they do the special effects in movies the other day. So I got out my green screen and I said, right, I'm going to show you how they do the effect of an evil spirit possessing a boy while he's having breakfast. And this is what we shot. As you can see, he's preparing himself for the tsunami of rage that's about to hit him because he betrayed my trust and smashed the bolt. You know, it's important for children to remember that fun is all well and good, but it often comes at a terrible price. That's one of the lessons that I hope to include in this new book that I want to write about parenting, and it's going to be called Fun Dad. And I've got my five-year-old daughter to record like a little endorsement to help raise funds for this project, and this is what we came up with.
This is an excellent book and I can heartily recommend it.
Yay, we got it!
Yeah. Off you go. But that was actually an incredibly fraught afternoon of filming. It looked simple, but it really wasn't. That was just the tip of the iceberg there. I'll show you some of the outtakes of that afternoon.
Go!
This is an excellent book and I can heartily recommend it.
Look at the camera.
This is an excellent book and I can heartily recommend it.
Looking at the camera without moving around. For goodness sake, we're on a budget here. Come on. All right, give me an American accent on the line, please.
This is an excellent book and I can heartily recommend it.
I mean, that sounded to me... I don't know what it sounded like. Let's try Scottish.
I can't do Scottish.
Well, why does it say you can on your CV?
This is an excellent book and I can heartily recommend it.
Come on, it sounds like a joke the way you're saying it.
Oh!
This is your favourite book and people have to really believe it. Try again.
This is an excellent book and I can heartily recommend it.
That's just insane. No one speaks like that. Do it normally.
I had enough of this. You can stick this mic up your bum.
So cute.
Ladies and gentlemen, Adam Buxton.
Oh, so how did the penis extensions actually work?
Well, you just measure it from further back.
Adam, what have you been up to since we last had you on the show? What have you been up to?
Well, the best thing for me last year was that I got a job. And it was at the local pub, and they have a problem with fairly slippery floors there. So I got the gig of being the guy that checks the slipposity of the pub floors. This is me actually at work. You gotta be careful. Oh.
Adam Buxton, I mean. Okay, time to go across to Victory Corner. Adam, what have you got for us?
It's time for Commentary Corner, Jimmy.
It's kind of a somber commentary corner because this is a David Bowie commentary corner. I was absolutely gutted when Bowie died earlier this year. I was a fan since I was about 10 or something. And since he died, I've spent more than the usual amount of time on YouTube, where, of course, his incredibly varied career is archived. And this morning, in fact, I was looking at the very first Bowie video that I remember seeing on TV in 1983 for Let's Dance. I'll call it up on my search history here. I was looking at it earlier on. it's been a lot of Bowie viewing the last... OK, here we go. Here's a clip of Let's Dance, this directed by David Mallet. Bowie said that that video was a very simple, very direct statement against racism and oppression. That's what Bowie thought. But what did the YouTube community have to say about it? Here's a cross-section of some of the genuine comments left by the YouTubers that I was looking at, beginning with one from Lucio Amo, who says, David Bowie is a legend. I didn't have to look at him for long to realise. His face says it all when he's singing, and the clip is very touching and real. The scene they meet on the street, the girl cleaning and the guy pulling that shit. I was really moved. And it is very moving, isn't it, when you see a guy pulling some shit. Here's a comment from Disco Dan, the 71st of the Proud.
Disco Dan the Plan.
He says, first time I heard this tune was playing Kiss Case in the dark. Oh, to be young again. I mean, they were wonderful times. I actually still enjoy myself playing Kiss Case. Has to be in the dark, or it's not nearly as exciting. Dan Smith has this contentious question to ask. Did David Bowie have sex with Mick Jagger? Full stop after question mark. Before all you homophilics sprue your venom. I'm just asking.
So, the homophilic community...
There's no need to start spruing venom. Because Dan's just asking. Homeless Hannah says, David is an electric performer. I'm so confident about that word, I'm going to put it in caps. He's electric. He doesn't just do a certain sound, but racists always try to pigeonhole white artists. Yeah. Like they did with Sting. It's always the pigeonholing. It happened with Sting.
Junior Kunde makes this observation about the video. The tooth of Bowie are very ugly. On 80s, not exist dentist to Bowie. Only gnomes. And finally, here's a comment from Saki 2877, who says, ironically, this is the worst song to dance to. Now, that can't be right, can it? I'm going to have to try this out.
Oh, my God. What's he got on?
Are you going to dance to David Bowie's Let's Dance?
I'm going to try and prove to you that it's not the worst song to dance to. All right, here we go. I think it is a sexy, sensual song, and I think there's an obvious way to dance to it.
Buxton, everyone. Okay, time to go across the dictionary corner one last time. Adam, what have you got for us?
Now, Jimmy, I love music. My favourite kind of music is great music. And that's why I love these guys. It's the Beach Boys.
The sea's been rough, hasn't it?
They are one of the genuine living legends in the world of pop. I love the Beach Boys. I get very excited at the whiff of a Beach Boy. So I was excited when the BBC, that's the big British castle, went and plundered a classic Beach Boys tune, God Only Knows, in order to trumpet their greatness for the music department. And they made a promo that was like an amazing tribute featuring pretty much every big name in the world of music. And the architect of that song himself, Brian Wilson, was in the promo right at the end, singing the final line. But I was very upset to see that a lot of people were carping online about his voice and saying, oh, he's too old to be doing this, and they've auto-tuned his voice and double-tracked it. And I thought, that is well disrespectful to one of the real, genuine, living legends of pop. And I thought, OK, I'm going to dig out a clip of the Beach Boys playing on TV not so long ago, on Later with Jules, and they were singing a classic Beach Boys song, Barbara Ann, and I just wanted to play it in to show they've still got it. There was a slight problem with the audio on the clip, so I've tweaked it ever so slightly, but you should get the idea.
Ha ha ha!